Hi, I'm Aaron Neuwirth with ETF Trends and ETF Database. I'm joined here by Chris Humer, Senior Investment Strategist at FlexShares Exchange Traded Funds. Chris, how are you doing?
Hi, Aaron. How are you doing today?
I'm doing well. From a factor perspective, value is off to a good start for the year. Do you have any insight on why that may be occurring?
Yeah, absolutely. Let's put this in context with, from 2020 to 2021. If you think about some of the sectors that underperformed last year, those sectors are rebounding to begin this year in some way. So sectors like energy, financials, real estate underperformed last year. And if you think about it from a value index perspective, typically on a non sector neutral basis, those sectors tend to be more exposed to value than growth and tend to have larger weights in value than sectors like technology. So, something that we've seen in non-sector neutral portfolios is totally that value has been off to a very strong start. So to put that in context, if you were to look at the Russell 3000 value compared to the Russell 3000 growth from the beginning of the year to through 3/23, March 23rd, their spread between those two is 9.06%. Now, we tend to look at things through a sector neutral lens, meaning that we try to be as neutral to the core blended index as possible. But even through that lens, you see that value is outperforming. The reasons we feel behind it, or that I feel personally about this, is if you think back to last year with the pandemic, I think investors viewed that there was few growth opportunities in the market, and so that led shares in those companies that were well positioned during the pandemic environment, things like technology, to actually do very well. So, investors paid up for the few growth opportunities that were available. As we turn to this year and expectations around reopening, and we've seen a little bit more of a reflation trade, what we've seen is those companies that were underpriced compared to those areas that took off last year, as well as those segments of the market that are more economically sensitive, have started to do well this year. And I think that's weighing into why we're seeing value outperform as we look through almost through the first quarter of the year.
Great. What other factors have been doing well this year?
Yeah. I think that's a good question because, value has definitely gotten a lot of attention, but there's definitely other segments of the market that also fit into that. Obviously, kind of a cousin to value, dividend yield has been off to a good start as well. But I think the one that has gotten the least attention, that shouldn't, and that should be looked at more, is size. I think if you look at it both from a small cap perspective versus large cap. So, if you looked at it from like a Russell 1000 to a Russell 2000, again, from beginning of the year until March 23rd, Russell 2000 has outperformed the Russell 1000 by 6.54%. We saw this actually start at the end of last year, where we saw a small cap start to outperform, but that's definitely continued on through this year. But also, when we look at the large cap space exclusively, you're seeing the lower end of the smaller end of the large cap space outperform the mega cap state. So we're definitely seeing a market where size is outperforming as well, which is good to see that multiple factors are doing well.
Okay. I know you're not a proponent of factor timing. What is another approach investors can take to get exposure to factors and be positioning when these factors do well?
Yeah, and let me explain that, because you're absolutely right. Generally speaking, while we do view factors through several different lenses, like how overpriced or underpriced a factor may be, and why we feel that a factor might be doing well, like value is today. Generally speaking, we find that trying to time factors and move in and out of them is a really difficult proposition to take into account. And even people that I would consider the forefronts of
the thought leadership and the factor space tend to shy away from picking entry and exit points when it comes to factors. What we find is a better way to go about getting factor exposure is getting consistent exposure through time. And there's ways that you could introduce that into a portfolio that takes less tracking error than if you were taking large factor bets. You know, I think one of the ways we do that is through a tilt approach to factor exposures. And what you're doing in those cases are you're really simply just adjusting the weights of your factor exposures to take exposure to size or value, whatever you wanted to target. So example of what we do, we have a series of factor tilt products built on Morningstar indices. And really what they're doing is simply taking the weights from large cap and growth companies and reallocating a portion of that weight to smaller and mid cap companies and value companies. So you're still owning those mega cap growth names. So in a period like last year, where some growthy mega cap names had strong performance, you still own them, just slightly less weight than you would from a market cap experience. But then when you have periods where size and value are doing well, like now, you have that additional exposure to those factors so that over the long run, you have less tracking error. You're able to ride it through those periods where growth and large caps are doing well, but you still maintain good exposure to size and value over time. So that would be a great way to go about it. That is potentially an approach that investors could take on top of, you know, instead of factor timing.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Chris. This has been a lot of great info. We appreciate your insights and look forward to chatting with you soon.
Aaron, it was a pleasure. Happy to do it again.